residents and businesses as to the consequences. The police contract is the largest expense of the village, so I understand trying to cut costs, but what will we give up in service and safety? When there is a break-in, rents are priceless.
That's a tiny part of me.
No, no, I started my timer starting to do it.
I'm just kidding, that's trustee Sam trying to communicate with us.
When there is a break-in, minutes are priceless. With Lake County Sheriff's Office 30 to 45 minutes away, will this in any way affect our insurance rates now or in the future? I think she's talking about the village self-insurance through IMR, I don't think. Okay, in addition, unless there are other extenuating circumstances, the village of Kildare is breaking its contract with Kildare Police. Does this open the village up to more legal expenses, which are already running high for a village of our size? How does this affect the red light cameras and hearings? Well, I personally am not in favor of the cameras because none of the money generated goes to improve the road safety. It is solely a revenue source. If I ever receive a ticket, my preference is to go to a local police station rather than having to drive to Waukegan. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Kathy? Mike, you wanna speak?
Well, just a question, point of, I get the impression that this is it, this evening, you gotta do what you're gonna do.
No, it's up for discussion.
Oh, it's not like the vote?
It could, we need a motion, this is a public forum right now.
So.
The people are expressing their opinions.
Right, so if we have anything to say, we better say it now, because we may not get another opportunity, is that not correct?
That could be.
Okay, then I'd like to be on the list.
Well, then you're gonna have to come up with it when she gets through. You're the stage, this is your 5 minutes.
Yes.
I will be 5 minutes. My name is Kathy Newton, I live at 12612 Long Way in the village of Deer Park. And I allow what Holly and Mark said, but I was just wondering, you said it was not a financial.
No, it's not.
Then I was wondering why it was being changed, I never read anything or knew anything that there was a problem. We've always had Kildare Police in our neighborhood and we were satisfied, and we've had homeowners association meetings where they came and helped residents about like break-ins that occurred, so I was just wondering why we were looking into something else.
You can ask whatever you want to make your comments, but right now I can't answer that question. Okay, thank you.
Did you say you were about money?
Yes.
Yep.
I thought somebody said about saving.
Linda Wright?
Hi, I'm Linda Wright, I live at 205 Deer Valley Drive. The reason I'm here is because I found out from our events, but I lived in Deer Park for almost 12 years, and we had Lake County and then we had the Kildare Police, and I've only had positive experiences with them, and I didn't realize that, I mean, I did hear a thing saying that they were gonna even consider changing the police. It's just that, you know, I didn't even hear about it, and it's, I was just concerned that they would try to change something that would affect everybody without even letting the residents know. So that's all.
Howard, do you wanna make any comments? We need everybody up to make comments. The reason I bring this up is, this was a discussion with the previous board too, before these board members were.
Thank you for the opportunity, President. I'm Howard Front, 21288 Black White, Deer Park.
You have to sign in, you know that. You get shot, the police department will haul you away if you don't sign in.
I don't think so. I was on the planning commission for many years, and I'm the chairman of the planning commission, village trustee for about 6 years. When I first came here, we had Lake County as they've expressed, enterprise, and I would agree with Maureen that I think it deserves some openness with the village to let people know why. I'm sure you will be discussing the reasons why, but so far you're hearing opinions as to why not, but the village hasn't heard as opinions as to why. And I think that that should be before you can really get an intelligent decision or discussion from the trust, from the village residents. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard. We're going to do that next, because I think there's one person besides me. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Mike, you want to speak?
Okay, sure.
I'll turn it down, I guess. Is that four all those three?
You have to speak loudly.
Okay. Like
on my right, so I got a guy in front of my face, got a guy on the right.
Why don't you just stop now, Mike?
What?
This is too personal.
No, I don't care.
No, I'm serious.
I think the personal is important.
No.
You're gonna invite these guys to your house?
No, I'm not.
The guy was a goon. And look at my arms. He wasn't gonna be satisfied till the two of them laid me on the floor, face down, put my hands behind my back and tied them to demonstrate what they can do.
Like you remember.
They kicked me out by both my arms in this fashion. My entire weight of my body was pulling on those. And I said to them, I had a hip replacement last January. Don't screw it up. I said to him, I had a laminectomy in my back. The year before that, it's considered high-level spinal surgery. I told him I had a shot in my knee last week.
Please.
Okay.
Please, just walk away.
All right.
Believe me, we've been friends a long time.
Well, I don't want people like that coming to my house.
You made your point.
For any damn reason.
You made your point. Thank you. Linda Wright, did you get a chance to speak?
Yeah, I did. Thank you.
Okay. Larry Winkleman?
Took all this effort to deal with our servant
usage of their time, how is that allocated back and forth between our sheriffs and county commissioners? And the mission of being asked to contractually across the summer. That would be that. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the public comments. No one else has any comments. Chief, you stand for the virtual professional. This gives you the opportunity to speak.
Thank you, sir.
I don't think I said it.
Thank you, Mayor. Trustees and residents of Deer Park. First and foremost, I want to thank each and every one of you for all your comments tonight. I take each and every one of them to heart. And I appreciate the support you've given us and also some of the complaints you have. And I will address each and every one of yours. The second thing is that right now, we are still your police department. Our patch still has Deer Park on it. Our cars still say Deer Park. We will continue to serve your community like we serve our community with pride, dignity, and commitment. You have my word on that. If whatever transpires at the end of this meeting, or doesn't transpire, we will do, and I will do everything possible to make the transition as smooth and as possible so you and your community stay safe. We will not do anything to hinder that whatsoever. I've been prepared for months with a PowerPoint presentation to address any issues that the board or the community may have regarding what we offer the Village of Deer Park, the services we offer, and what we provide. That offer still stands. Hopefully, the board takes that up. They won't do it next week because I will be out of town. But besides that, I've been the chief of police at Shield Deer for approximately a year and 2 months. So I take this personal because this situation is happening on my watch. I take total responsibility for any actions that my officers may or may not take. And again, you have my commitment that we will be there for you to the very last second. And when the mayor says if he wants us or doesn't want us, you have my word. Besides that, each and every one of you have my report for last month. I just want to go over a couple of things that came up since I emailed this out to you. We had two personal injury accidents on Lake Cook in Wallingford. One happened Saturday night, Sunday morning, and the second one happened Monday morning, where we had to shut down traffic. And the reason why I'm bringing up the second one specifically is because we had to shut the road down and we diverted traffic on Deer Path and went in front of Mr. Buckingham's house, and we did all we could to make sure that the traffic continued to go northbound on Deer Path and not make any U-turns and come back around. So if there was any complaints by Mr. Buckingham regarding that, that's what transpired on Monday morning on Lake Cook Road. The other thing is that on September 27th, a resident in Kill Deer, we had another Roost burglary. It happened approximately 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Two or three individuals saw that an elderly individual had a car for sale in his driveway. They approached him. The car wouldn't start, so they got him to go in to try to jump the cars. They kept him busy. Another individual went up into the house and ransacked their bedroom for jewelry. They didn't notify us until besides that, that's all I have. And again, whatever decision the board makes, it's been an honor and a pleasure to serve each and every one of you. And I speak from our police department, it's been an honor and pleasure to serve each and one of your residents, and I thank you for it.
We thank you. Next item on the agenda, space study. Thank you.
Okay. If you recall, Mark Bushhouse from Williams and Associates was commissioned to do a space studies, the office needs, and when the village board approved the agreement, it made it clear and stipulated that it would hold the programming at the point of just programming space. And what Mr. Bushhouse has supplied is the part that programs the space, but it has certain caveats in there based on where the body of the space would be located. And that ranges between 2,000 and 5,000. And with that, I'll turn over to Mark.
Thank you, Jim. Trustees, we spent some time looking at the space uses in your current Village Hall office area.
I just want to say to make sure you look, it's on page 161 of your packet.
Thank you. We spent time with your staff looking at the space uses within the current Village offices, looking at the storage areas, looking at the basement, looking at the storage down there. Spent time talking with Jim about the space uses, and as indicated, we then prepared a space program, and you have a copy of, which on a gross square footage level does have a range of 2,100 to 5,200 square feet. The range is quite a bit, and the reason the range is that difference is because it's based on basically two different approaches. If these offices for the village are located within a building that already has its own mechanical electrical rooms, already has its own lobby and bathrooms, has other main meeting spaces located within that building, then the space allocated for just Village Hall offices can be the smaller 2,000 square feet. The 5,000 square feet is based on the other possibility, and that would be to build a freestanding building that would be Village Hall offices. So it would need its own bathroom, it would need a room for the electrical equipment, a room for the mechanical equipment, and so on. So that could be a freestanding, self-supporting facility. So clearly the space program tells us several things. One, space usage, the space needs is there, it's real. We really have a program for really much growth. I think we have one space in there that's got four or five uses to it, one of which could be future, but it could also be used by your IT consultant. He's working in the buildings. It could also be used by an intern when they periodically are used to help out. So we really haven't tried to look for significant growth because that's the understanding is real growth in staff is not something the village believes has in its future anytime soon. So if these offices were located in the room that's downstairs in this building, just about all of that could fit into that room that's there. Then that means you already have a lobby, the front doors, you have bathrooms, obviously you have a heating system and electrical equipment already in this building. You have a kitchen already, so a place to make coffee or something is already provided. So those are all spaces that this building could provide. Therefore, that space is reasonably close to graduate. Also, if you took the space and went into a facility to rent space, that also probably has shared toilets, would have its own lobby, would have its own mechanical electrical room. So you could also rent something fairly close to the 2,000 square feet, and that also could work for you. From my understanding of what the board has been
needs be if we were to do an addition to the barn here?
The barn, it probably would be fairly close to the 2,000 square feet.
Or perhaps even a little bit more, but somewhere in the middle here. It wouldn't be 5,000 square feet.
I would say closer to the 2,000.
Would you?
Probably a little more than 2,000. Might be down a hallway or something.
Okay. That's very interesting.
So you think the space in there is sufficient?
It basically, well, we haven't been asked yet to go in and explore the layout in that room. So we're a little premature here for me to give a definitive answer to that. That room has some columns in it. It has a section of the floor that's higher along one edge than the rest of the floor. So how that would impact the actual layout of the space, we haven't investigated that yet. But I do believe that almost all the spaces that we went through would likely fit in there or be very close.
But professionally, I imagine you have some concerns, though, with the water leakage issues down there.
Well, certainly if that space had ongoing and unstoppable water leakage into it, that would likely make it certainly not an ideal space, and frankly, maybe an unacceptable space to have offices and people working in on a routine basis. Certainly, the need to resolve the water issue would be very important for the people.
Thank you.
But your basic assumption is we need, you're saying here, a minimum of 2,100, then we can go up to 5,200 square feet.
Again, depending on those two options, or two approaches.
Yes.
So that lower level, which is, I guess, the museum area downstairs and the entry area that you walk into, those two combined would get us close to 2,100?
The main room back there is less than 2,000, but it's not significantly less. As we were looking at, you know, what could go where and what else could fit in other parts of the building, it was looking plausible. But again, like I said, we're getting a little ahead of ourselves to ask for a definitive answer until we actually try to lay it out and see if it fits as well as we would hope it would.
And we're not talking about any growth or any future, but we're just talking today, trying to take something and fit it into the existing space.
Today, yes, probably some better spaces than they have now, a bit more storage than they have now, and a meeting room to meet with citizens versus either keeping them out on the front porch or bringing them into the interior of the spaces. So there certainly are improvements, but not expecting to actually go out and hire more staff.
We use the business model that we're using now in terms of contracting out this small conference room. Could also be one to meet with developers, auditors, anything that would have a group of 6 to 8 people, which we had in the past at the village office, but now that we hold here.
The objective was to get what our workload is, divide our employees with space to do the work in relationship to the barn and the layout of the office. The office building. It was not to take what we had here and design it into it. It was just to find what our basic needs were by employee and by function to figure out what space they require. Now our option is to go to the next step, which is to find the location to put the space required.
Aside from the square footage,
I
think the layout of the building would result in
I'd say it's plausible, but again, I can't give you a definitive answer yet. It's one of the aspects of the studies to say, well, based on where you might want to locate, it doesn't work well there. And as I'm saying, it's plausible, but I don't know.
Yes.
Lou's gonna be doing some maintenance work, actually, they're probably out there, this month, the last couple of weeks, doing some additional fall maintenance work in Swansea, both Swansea and the Ferndale area. Just to keep the board up to speed with the Ferndale Rain Gardens, they also did the same error with mowing, a little bit below the specifications that we provided to hold the payment for that work until next spring, part of their, work to rectify this work out of specs was to do additional seeding next spring to, in only the buffer area of Rain Gardens, so that work's gonna be done next spring.
Hey, Todd, have we used them before? Are they familiar with the requirements? It sounds like they had a couple issues this time.
They had not worked in this village. We've worked with them before in Alter, Woods, and Bannockburn. It was one of those groups that the mowing a little bit lower than they should have. Mowing should have been like 6 to 8 inches for the buffer area, and they mowed it to the ground. But we negotiated with them to make sure we get some of the buffer area that we had in the past is to do a full reseed next spring at their cost. And they've also did additional plantings in the rain garden to make up for this error of specification.
So there's nothing you want to hold back to ensure the activity for next spring?
Right now we haven't paid anything for work in the permit. So we have, and we will, and they know that as part of this agreement that they won't get paid for any work that they did last spring as well as what they're gonna do in 2012 spring. The next item we had talked about, Ela Township was scheduled for doing some work in the village, some minor storm sewer improvements, repairs, but based on their schedule, and part of it was due to some of the rain events we had in July, they weren't able to do the work this year for the village, so we had talked at last month's meeting to get a quote from Bartnick Construction to do this work, and the three locations were Primrose, Wallingford, and Deer Valley. Primrose is on hold. We're looking at the Bartnick an alternate solution to that problem, but for the two areas, Wallingford and Deer Valley Road, we did receive a quote from Bartnick for a total of $15,494, and Elick Township's quote to do this work prior, which was approved at the previous board meetings, was $14,085. So Bartnick's number was above what Ela Township's numbers were for those two projects. We ended up going back to Bartnick and advised them that what number we had already, and Bartnick agreed to meet the same number that Ela had, so there wouldn't be any increased dollar amount. And that's, I believe, consistent with what the board and I talked about last month. So I would be looking for the board to approve Bartnick's quote for both projects and that amount, which was $14,085.
They're going to do both for the same amount as Ela Township.
Right.
Okay.
So we would enter.
Jim, why don't you just advise the board who's going to, you know, the highest regard for Ela Township. They have so much work right now that they're holding us back. Can you refer to that?
Yes. And we've talked about this with Trustee Sands, and we recommend that you approve the proposal from Bartnick to do the Deer Valley and the Wallingford work.
At a cost of $14,085. Okay, we have a motion to that.
So How much do you think this is going to be, Tom, to just give me a range, just set expectations?
I would say probably 15,000. And that's all covered under the special service area sewer fund. Or not special service area, but the sewer fund.
The sewer fund, yes.
That's my report on the decision. And the last item.
Let me get one before that. Let me just bring one up to the board. In your comment too, the village itself, Barrington, has a generator. It's Cummins. It's 11 years old. It has 225 to 250 hours on. It has 277 to 480 watts. It's a 100 kilowatt generator. It's about 5 feet high, 4 to 5 feet wide, and 3 foot deep. Presumably, the mayor has offered that to us free of charge. The administrator has talked to South Barrington. The administrator has talked to Jim. And that may not be true. They may want some money for it. But if we want it, it's there. But the problem we have is this really a good thing? Because we could use it either on the barn or on the office. The problem is that it's natural gas. It could cost us $5,000 or $6,000 to install it. Do we want to think about this? What do you think, Todd?
Jim and I talked a little bit about it, and one, I guess, I would suggest that we can have Chuck Bowden from our office to take a look at it. Chuck Bowden has worked or just retired from the village with over 30 years' experience.
It's on Bartlett Road right now, one block south of 72, on the east side of the street.
They're changing over Santurce, new station, right?
Yeah, we're familiar with South Barrington, and all the village residents, right?
Okay, now you're up to the $1 million question.
Well, just by that, I assume the board wants Walt Hamilton to look at this?
Yeah, I think it's a good idea.
Okay. I just say, before we were led to believe it was free, and now I'm hearing that they may have a price, but I'm sure they would entertain some for the village if it, you know, desired it.
So having a backup generator would be
yes.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Good idea. This is a $7,000 to $15,000 generator, new for hire.
Is it an automatic startup? When power goes down, does it kick on?
Yeah, it's got a natural gas. It's just like
a natural gas. It's powered on natural gas.
Probably still
yeah. Yeah. Which would be all yeah, I think they should give it to us.
Are you too?
Yeah. And I want to go on public record with them.
Okay. Now for the $1 million question.
I got
you. No, you stay on this one.
All right. Last month's meeting, Bob had asked, Kellerman had asked Bob Hamilton from our office to do an assessment on the drainage of the lower level of the baby barn. I believe everybody has Bob's Hamilton's memo with some of the exhibits. And then also as part of on my agenda was Randy
Pinchum. For the people that don't know now, we've had a water problem. Water comes through the concrete into the lower level. And it's been substantial. That's what we are addressing right now. When it rains outside, the water doesn't come through the roof. It does not come through the sidewalls. It comes through the basement up into the building. It's kind of a unique situation. size of those gutters.
Right.
Significantly.
Well, we would try to get up to the next size with this, something, and, if the board, once we make a decision, then we would